You are now listening to a member of the Disney Podcast family. Head over to Disney Podcast Family on Instagram to see all the latest posts for this show and links to other great Disney podcasts.
Welcome to another episode of Knights of the Rogue Republic. This is Amber, and I'm here with our co-cast members,
Jade and
Joe.
How's it?
Knights of the Rogue Republic is our Star Wars spin-off show of the Walt's Apartment podcast. So thank you for joining us as we do a little dive into the coming Ahsoka series, and we want to share our passion for Rebels with you all and how that is going to tie in to the Ahsoka series coming out later this month. This happens to be Jade's favorite Star Wars stuff to talk about. If you haven't watched any of our other or listened to any of our other podcasts, Ahsoka is Jade's girl, the Rebels series is like her favorite Star Wars.
Probably Clone Wars.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. The OG.
Animated Clone Wars is definitely number one. Rebels is right up there, though. You know, if I had to go episode to episode, there'd definitely be some Rebels up there.
So we're very hyped, to say the least, about Ahsoka having her own live action series now.
Yes. Very excited to see her, what she's been up to. I'll say that.
Looks like a lot.
Looks like a lot. Quite a bit. She's a busy gal. She gets around the galaxy.
So they've basically confirmed that the Ahsoka series is basically the next season of Rebels, pretty much. That's what it's alluding to be. So little recap of the Rebels series and some of the main characters that we've already seen in the trailer, some that we suspect to see, will probably help you guys get a little insight to what's going to happen.
And I have not been keeping up a whole lot on some of the info out there. Do we know an exact time period yet on which when this is set? Is this pre-Mandalorian when she appears in the live-action version in The Mandalorian? Or do we know?
It looks like there's been some time jumps. Because just from the views of Sabine alone, we first see her with long hair. Mm-hmm. And then later on in the latest trailer, we see her Mulan style cut her hair off, but then it pretty much looks like they mirror the last shots from the series finale of the animated show, where she's standing in front of the mural she made of the ghost crew and with Ahsoka and stuff. So I think it might be a little bit of a time jump, but I would think it'd be fairly on the timeline of where how Mando's going after they parted ways in season two. Or Book of Boba Fett.
Mandalorian 2.5.
Yeah, pretty much.
So at the same time this is happening, Luke is making the training temple.
Yeah.
Yes, most likely.
Which makes sense, too, because even at the finale of Rebels was even a time jump, because the show takes place before Battle of Yavin, then jumps past the Return of the Jedi timeline. Then the whole epilogue, I think, is at least 2 years or something after.
Yeah, so I looked it up. So basically we're going to spoil this anyways. Basically from when Ezra disappeared with Thrawn, it jumps forward and then you see Sabine looking out over the city that's clearly been rebuilt. I guess that's a year time right there. So like a little bit after the Empire falls, and then 5 year time jump to when she's standing there in front of the mural. So
sounds about right.
5 years after the Empire falls, a little bit more.
Which puts us right smack in the Mandalorian.
Yep.
Timeline.
Exactly. Okay. Plus Ahsoka's wearing the same outfit in like a lot of the shots too. So
that's
true. Yeah.
It would make sense.
Okay.
Yes.
I like it. going with it.
And makes sense with the Mandalorian, the few name drops of Thrawn too in the finale.
Yep,
that they're exactly. still waiting for him. So.
Yes. And clearly, what was that woman's name that she fought in the
with
Mandalorian
the
series? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She clearly is no longer ruling over whatever city that is in the trailer.
Uh-huh.
So it's got to be post that as well. So right in that little area. And then also there's that droid that pops up in the trailer that we recognize from the Clone Wars that helped all the younglings build their sabers. So likely Ahsoka's having some dealings with helping rebuild the Jedi Order. Maybe not super hands-on, but like a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I feel like maybe she's like helping Luke acquire certain things that he needs or something.
That would make sense, yeah. Morgan Elsbeth? Does that sound like the person in Mandalorian that she fought with the spear? Yes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Elsbeth? I don't know if that's how it's pronounced, but...
Right, yeah.
That's what IMDb says.
Okay, so let's rewind a little bit and talk about the key characters we know for sure. We'll start there from Ahsoka. And Ahsoka originated in Clone Wars, the animated series. She ends up popping into Rebels, end of season one.
Should we do a quick Ahsoka update in case nobody really knows who Ahsoka is besides Mandalorian? Like a quick overview. Quick overview.
Quick, yeah.
Quick overview. Pops up in the Clone Wars series in between what would be episode 2 and 3 as Anakin's Padawan. You see a lot of growth and development over that series. She becomes a pretty beloved character. At the end of the series, she leaves the Jedi Order because she was, like, wrongfully accused of a crime, and then she didn't trust the Jedi Order anymore, so she went off on her own. And then towards the end of, like, episode 3, when the Republic's falling and all of that, you kind of see how she was helping the Mandalorian. And then, you know, she's also in the Rebel series kind of working with the Resistance, and she has some interactions with the Ghost crew, which is a lot of the characters we're seeing in the trailer.
Yeah, and in Rebels, when she appears in the series, it's as Fulcrum at first, and it's not revealed who she is till the end of season one as like a spy for the rebellion.
Yes, yes.
That the Ghost crew had contact with. And then that spy handle gets transferred to another person later. But we won't spoil that. Just go watch the show. It's good.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
10 out of 10 would recommend. There's still time to watch the whole thing until the Ahsoka series comes out, so, you know.
It's a lot of watching, but it's possible.
It's possible.
Okay, so one of the main characters, Rebels focuses on a crew of the ship, the Ghost, mm-hmm. And it's kind of a ragtag bunch of crew members, but you have a kind of space mom, space dad vibe going with Hera and Kanan, who we see in the Clone Wars and in the Bad Batch briefly.
Yes, but
as a Padawan.
Spoiler, he's not going to be in this series.
Correct, because he is no longer with us.
Yes, he sacrificed himself for
his family.
He is one with the Force.
Yes, yes. Of course. So Hera and Kanan are like space mom and dad, and they kind of bring in other misfits of the galaxy to kind of stick it to the Empire, but not like officially in a rebellion formal way at first, right? They're just
stealing. They're like, yeah, it's
scrapping.
I was going to say, just like a Robin Hood, mm-hmm. you know, help liberating Empire occupied planets and cities. This is right at the very beginning of the rebellion. They're more of a cell, a rebel cell, but still nothing's really organized yet, except Hera has communication. Only Hera really has any communications with some of the higher-ups, which, you know, we don't find out until we find out about Fulcrum and how involved, like, Bail Organa is and stuff. So,
yep.
Very early days of the rebellion.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so they've brought on Sabine and Ezra as, you know, kind of the younger members of the group. Zeb, I don't remember how Zeb became a part of. Did they ever talk about the history there with
him
coming to the crew?
Not that I can recall right now. I just remember, obviously, his home world was decimated by the Empire.
Yeah.
But yeah. I don't remember them specifically saying, oh, we saw Zeb here and brought him on mm-hmm. board or something.
But Rebels starts out with the Ghost crew adding Ezra to the team, basically.
Yeah, Ezra is pretty much Space Aladdin at the beginning. He's a little orphan a little street rat that's messing with the Empire on his own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's like a little Robin Hood, joins the bigger Robin Hood crew.
Yeah.
And then Chopper, who's their trusty droid, who, if you like R2 and his shenanigans, Chopper takes it to a whole new level.
Mm-hmm. He's got his own body count and everything.
Yeah. It's a big one.
Yeah, it's a doozy.
Yeah.
And a few little side notes, too, for like a lot of old school Star Wars fans that maybe haven't tapped into Rebels, like a lot of the art style is that early Ralph McQuarrie style of characters, like Zeb. It was the original look for Chewbacca back in the day. Chopper was the original look for R2 and a couple other droids we see, original C-3PO and stuff. So it's cool that kind of pay nod to a lot of that old concept art from the 70s. I think.
Yeah. And it dives way more, the series dives way more into the kind of philosophical pieces of the story that George Lucas had in extra material that never made it into the films. It really explores some of that deeper elements of the Force and components that you don't really get to explore much in the movies. So
yeah, things they don't either have time for or the capabilities of doing when the movies came out. Mm-hmm. There's some pretty cool stuff.
Yeah. So who do we want to talk about first? Hera, I think, probably. And
we could give it. Yes,
which one do you think is going to be the bigger role, Sabine or Hera?
I feel like it's got to be Sabine.
It's going to be Sabine, but Hera, I think, with Hera being the leader of the crew. But, I mean, either one. I mean, they're going to be big characters. They're prominent. Yeah.
It feels like they're not all together, right? Like, Sabine and Hera have gone their separate ways, it seems.
Yeah.
All kind of doing their own thing.
Yeah. See, that's why I feel like maybe Zeb's not even going to be in the show.
But we know Zeb's in the rebellion. So I feel like he also probably took a different path, but he's still going to make an appearance.
Yeah. Okay.
And I think he showed up on Mandalorian because he's not going to be in this show.
Really?
But doesn't mean we won't see him in the future. And I could get to that later.
Yeah.
Okay.
I feel like if we do see him, it's going to be like just for a short little something, if that. I don't know. I'm not going to say for sure.
But... All right. Well, I know Joey is thinking he's going to end up in another series, potentially, as one of the pilots in the.
Well, maybe along with some of the crew in the. I'll just start say right now. We all know we're in. We were going to get the Ranger or the was it the Rangers of the New Republic, a show that was supposed to focus with Cara Dune, and that has fell through. But I think in ways they're reworking it with Zeb, with Carson Teva, the X-Wing captain that's been showing up. Great character. And I think why not have the Rebel Ghost crew headline that show if it happens. So that's just a little fan hope.
I could see it.
Yeah.
Because I still think Ahsoka is going to be more than one season.
Yeah, I agree. And if it's not, I'm just going to cry.
Okay, so Sabine.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, we'll just start with Sabine.
So Sabine is a Mandalorian.
Yes, Mandalorian in the House of Ren. And that's one of, like, the bigger houses in the Mandalorian culture before, you know, the Empire... Did a number on him, and she's the youngest daughter of the House of Ren, and she kind of worked for the Empire when they were starting out making them weapons. She's kind of a little crafty, you know, weapons maker, bombs, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. She loves graffitiing, which you kind of see with her colorful armor. She'll like tag certain things when they're, you know, sticking it to the Empire. Let's see. So she's kind of closed off and doesn't really talk a lot about all of that, but then it comes out in later episodes that her family kind of disowned her because she was making a weapon for the Empire that could basically wipe out Mandalorian, so she didn't want to be a part of it, left the Empire, and then that's how she wound up on the Ghost crew. Yeah. Anything else to add there?
Nope, that's right. And she did actually make the weapon, right? It targets Beskar.
She made it. And then they wanted her to, like, make it bigger or something, and then she, like, destroyed all of her work, at least she thought.
And but that comes back later.
Yeah, ran from the Empire.
Yeah. So somehow she ends up with the Ghost crew. She was already there before the series starts, so we don't really learn how she connected.
But she became part of the Ghost crew. Hera and Kanan kind of took her in, like, parental-ish figures for her. And then we see her in the Ahsoka trailer.
And she, in the cartoon, she, or at the show, she would always paint Chopper's Imperial disguise, which is just basically black and red paint. So.
Yep. Chopper got a lot of paint jobs.
Yeah.
Yes. And she is the one that initially we know had the Darksaber.
Oh, yes, Darksaber.
So that came into play in the Mandalorian series. And I know we talked a little bit about that tie-in when we went through the season of The Mandalorian, but she was the wielder of the Darksaber and trained with it for a little while before giving it to Bo-Katan. Mm-hmm. And that then was the supposed curse or whatever, because Bo was given the Darksaber instead of earning it. But Sabine didn't want to lead. And yet she knew the wielder of the Darksaber kind of ends up being the pseudo leader of Mandalore. So she gave it away.
Yep.
And that storyline might have been one of the best arcs of the whole series of just the training, the that whole
learning to wield the Darksaber, all of that. Yeah. Good few episodes right there.
Yeah.
So that's an interesting thing, right? Because we see the Mandalorian, Din Djarin, struggle with using the Darksaber at first, as we do her in the season where she's getting her training with Kanan. But it's never really hint at that she had any Force abilities. Yet in the trailer with Ahsoka, she calls her master.
Yeah.
So there must have been some sort of Force sensitivity that existed. They just didn't play it up a whole lot.
But also when she was fighting the dark side user in the trailer, she says, the dark side user says, "You have no power." So, I mean, they could have just been editing in a certain kind of way, but that's what it was kind of alluding to in the trailer to me. So I don't know if maybe she doesn't have the Force power. Maybe Ahsoka was training her just to wield the saber.
But she'd already given the saber away.
But she had Ezra's trained her saber. But she already had training too, so it's like, I don't know.
Yeah, it's so strange.
Yes.
Yeah, because I haven't done my rewatch yet, but I'm pretty sure that Ezra gives her his saber before he leaves the board Thrawn ship. And it kind of little sidebar is like, throughout the series, like, it starts off, Ezra obviously has a crush on her, but she never played on it. And then they did a really good job since we had Kanan and Hera's, you know, their obvious love for each other. And of course, I'm jumping ahead a little bit, but Ezra and Sabine's relationship throughout the entire series was a very, very, not romantic, but still like, and I don't say romantic or brother sister, but if you guys imagine seen Shang-Chi, like him and Hades.
Yes. Like, imagine it like a schoolyard crush kind of a thing was what I always envisioned it as. Like,
yeah.
He and was always pining for her, and she was like, kind of like, nope.
Yeah. It looks like it's slightly playing a little bit off that.
Yeah.
In the little bit we've seen from the trailer. Mm-hmm.
Could be a thing.
Yeah. It's like you don't know what you had until it's gone.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, anything else on Sabine? I feel like that covers it pretty well.
Yeah. Other than, I mean, just watch the show because, I mean, yeah, she's the one that kind of diverts the rest of the crew to let Ezra escape. But yeah, I don't want to get too much in there. There's a lot to talk about. So.
Yeah, we could talk forever.
Yeah.
All right, so Hera.
Okay, Hera.
Hera's the captain of the Ghost. Mm-hmm. So she's like known to be a kick-ass pilot.
Yep.
They call her Space Mom. her and Kanan have a thing. Mm-hmm. What else? So we know she was part of the fledgling initial building of the rebellion.
Yeah, she's like the leader of their rebel cell. Ends up recruiting quite a bit of other rebels to the cause, you know, acquiring different ships, acquiring their little fleet. And yeah. She's the main one who has communications with the rest of all the fleets. And then they'll like later come together for certain things, you know, aid other cells with certain missions.
We find that she even doesn't tell the Ghost crew certain things just for their safety, you know, kind of carrying that weight. And character-wise, Hera is one of my favorite all-time Star Wars characters. Like, she is a great character, and one I'm super excited to see in live action. I think Mary Elizabeth Winstead is going to play her real, real good. But yeah, so I mean, she's been in the background of so many big moments in Star Wars, not just in Rebels, but if you listen carefully on Rogue One. You know, they're paging her as a general, General Syndulla. You see Chopper real briefly. You see the Ghost flying through the battle. You see the Ghost in the main battle of Rise of Skywalker. So she's always been in the background. Granted, those movies came out after Rebels, but still, it's cool that they incorporate
Although
that.
Although we don't know that she was piloting the Ghost in Rise. It could have been.
If you listen to the audiobook, which I did at my old work, a lot of the stories expanded. And in that scene, they actually do like a New Hope call sign. You hear like, you know, I forget who's saying something. They're talking to Poe. Then you hear different ships calling in, and you hear a female voice saying Ghost, you know, standing by and stuff. And that's in the audiobook. I was like, oh, hell yeah. You know, and they even have Kaz and the older guy from Resistance animated in that battle, too.
Okay.
Nice.
I can get behind it.
Yeah.
Other key parts about Hera. Very loyal.
Yeah.
Protective mama bear. And it seems like, again, that the Ghost crew have kind of spread out into other areas of the galaxy now. So I think that kind of protective looking out for stuff is translating now into the bigger rebellion is the vibe we're getting, right? We see her talking to Mon Mothma and others about kind of big moves that are happening.
Yeah, and if you go back to the show, now that I think of it, some of the more... She had the most conflict and dialogue with Thrawn in the show. Like, they both had a really good chess match and moves on, like, some of the later episodes. So, being the fact that they're both in a live-action form now, I just totally... You know, I'm thinking about Thrawn and Ezra, but Hera and Thrawn really...
That's true. Like
he had her family's heirloom. I mean,
yeah, the totem.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Little backstory on that. Just because we're talking about random things that people probably don't know about. Twi'lek, like, they have like a little piece of art, basically, that they all add to generation by generation. And when her home planet was taken over by the Empire, Thrawn got a hold of it and like kept it as one of his trophies. And then she later attempted to steal it back, got captured. Then eventually got it back later.
From Kanan.
Yep.
Yes. So Thrawn, speaking of, is one of the characters we'll talk about, and you'll have to like keep me from squirreling away to Thrawn because he's one of my favorites.
I think we should really quick, before we move on to Thrawn, do a quick Chopper because we just did Hera and they kind of tie together pretty well.
Okay.
So Chopper is the droid, which is like, it's the Ghost Crew droid, but it's definitely Hera's droid. She found him, crashed during the Clone Wars, and, you know, rebuilt him pretty much. So she's like really good buddies with him. Chopper already kind of went over him a little bit ago.
Got the spunkiness that he takes a whole bit further than R2 does.
Mm-hmm. Murder.
Pilots the ghost on his own. Kind of like makes decisions at a higher level than R2 did, right? For a droid, like he has his own motivations, his own drives. He doesn't wait for orders.
Yeah.
He just does whatever he feels he needs to do.
Beyond that, he doesn't even just not wait for orders. Sometimes he will go against orders. Because he wants something or wants to do something or thinks something would work out better if he did this. So,
yeah.
Constantly fighting with Ezra and Zeb.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that reminds me of, like, siblings, right? Yeah. Picking on each other, sibling rivalry. Yeah, like, very humanist characteristics for a droid.
Yeah, I think the most human-like droid we see.
Yep.
So, yeah.
I concur.
Yes.
Okay.
Now go ahead.
Okay, I'll go back to Thrawn. So, speaking of the totem and trophies, Thrawn, he's very analytical. Great strategist. You know, is known for his ability to think, like, in a chess match, just so many moves ahead of time. But what he is kind of passionate about on the side is studying culture's artwork and is able to, like, glean characteristics about a culture and about how somebody from that planet or that world or that family would act in a situation so that he could predict their moves, like, way into the future. So when you talk about Hera and him, like, tangoing, like, it is on a high, just, like, immeasurable level of sophistication and, gosh, I'm trying to think of the words to, like, properly describe how freaking smart they were and, like, yeah, just the whole strategy of the moves that they were making. And
well, just imagine the Empire Star General versus the Rebel Star General.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And Thrawn, even though he's loyal to the Empire, like his ultimate loyalty is to his homeworld, and he's in the Empire because he believes that the only way his homeworld and his universe is going to survive is by strengthening the Empire. So he is a amazing kind of anti-hero to read about and explore in the novels, because in the novels he isn't painted as a villain like you see him in the Rebels, totally being painted as a villain, and he is a great villain. But there's also, like, a lot of underlining, like, character components where is he really a villain? Like, maybe it seems like it in some moments, but when you're in the perspective of his story, he's not so much. So he's one of my favorites for that reason, because it's very easy to, like, get lost in the intricacies of his character.
So, like, the first books he's the villains, on the other ones he's anti. I mean,
there's a lot of cool history there.
Yeah. And you kind of see how cool of a guy he is. Just the fact that, you know, the Emperor is pretty against having alien species as high ranking officers, and Thrawn, the only non-human that very high level. So, and just a cool design, too.
he was one of the first people to figure out who Darth Vader was and very quickly on. So
one of the very few.
Yeah. So then we have, we mentioned Zeb, but we didn't really talk too much about him and his character. We don't think he's going to play a huge role in this, but...
You see him for a little snippet in the Mandalorian series. He was that purple guy in the bar.
Yeah. He's the muscle.
Yeah, he's basically the muscle. Not like a dumb brute, but, you know...
A brute.
A brute, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we find out he was pretty much like the king's guard of his people.
Yeah, exactly.
A royal, actually a royal, like a that was the guard. So. Yeah, pretty, yeah, knight. So. And so his story with Kallus was another great storyline.
Yeah.
So basically, kind of like the Mandalorian, they like tried to resist the Empire comes in, wipes out his people. He thinks there's like, all his people are wiped out. In the Rebel series, he finds out that they're hidden on this different world, and he helps a few of his, what was it, two people or two that he, like, rescued and then brought back to the home world with the help of, like, that old.
Yeah, two
woman.
Or three.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Of and, a family, yeah.
Yeah, and then, let's see. I don't know if we should dive too much into all
Yeah,
of
I don't
that.
Think it'll make too much of a difference. So then... At the end of Rebels, spoiler alert, we see another character appear, or rather be birthed.
We didn't that, say it be birthed, okay.
that we know will probably show up in some form or fashion in Ahsoka, and that would be Hera and Kanan's son, Jason, which I love that they... chose the name Jason because, you know, in Legends, Jason Skywalker is a thing. So I love they did that. And they spelled it the same way as in the old novels. So it's a little nod.
And I mean,
probably would be force sensitive because Kanan is a Jedi. So
yeah. And you kind of go through Kanan, like he was a Jedi in hiding that exposed himself as a Jedi and trained Ezra because they found out he was force sensitive. But throughout the entire show, you always felt that, even though it's a animated show, but you always felt that kind of, I don't want to say sexual tension, but him and Hera, you felt that you felt that bond, but
yes.
then it kind of pays off towards the end. But yeah, then finding out that he put a baby.
Yeah, so it was always alluded to.
Yeah.
And then, like, not towards, until the end of the show, was it, like, more confirmed.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. They were always close, but never, like, romantically close on screen.
Yes.
Yes.
They couldn't do that in front of the children.
Yeah. But quick little funny side story tangent. At the celebration in Chicago, I was watching on the live stage. Vanessa Marshall, who voices Hera, and Tia Sakaar, Sabine, they're talking, and this is after the show came out, and so they asked, they're like, because I guess Tia was the only one knew that Hera was going to be pregnant at the end. Dave only told her, but he was like, then so Hera, like at the finale when they see it, she's like, wait, what? And then she even asked Dave, when did that happen? And he was saying, well, remember, like, before the last scene with Kanan, but she's like, yeah, you guys were talking and it was sunset. Then it hit commercial. Then commercial came out and it was daytime. So it was like somewhere between the commercial and Disney XD. They got together. So,
okay. They snuck something in there.
That's funny.
Yeah.
So Ezra, we mentioned being kind of the Aladdin. Talked about him being trained in the Force. That plot of what happens to Ezra in the end of Rebels is going to have a lot to do, I think, with Ahsoka.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll just do a quick overview of Ezra?
Yep.
Okay. His parents were arrested by the Empire, so he was left to live on the streets of Lothal and kind of just, like, survive. So he's kind of what they called, like, a loth rat. And then he was he saw the ghost crew stealing something, so he decided to steal some of what they were stealing, and then they ended up bringing him on board the ghost. There was like a little test because Kanan, he found some of Kanan's more Jedi-like belongings pretty quickly, so they did a little test to see if he wanted to join the crew or just keep an object because he had a little collection where he was staying. He decided to join the crew and become a part of the ghost crew. He got trained in the Force by Kanan. Kanan was obviously struggling because, you know, when he never got his Jedi training completed. But eventually, you know.
Well, and he always struggled with guilt of feeling like he abandoned his master when Order 66 happened.
Yeah.
Keep going.
So, so he became a Jedi. He had a pretty cool lightsaber that actually, like, was a blaster / lightsaber. Like, only one like that kind of a thing. Fights Inquisitors. Eventually goes in. Should we talk about the World Between Worlds at all?
Oh, I mean, sure. I mean, that's all going to tie in.
Yeah.
He also met Maul.
Yeah.
He struggled with kind of the dark side a little bit.
Yeah. He looked into a dark side and light side holocron opening together and caught a glimpse of the future. Went to go warn Kenobi about Maul coming to attack him. You know, Kenobi obviously killed Maul. And then, he's back to the...
I mean, not obviously, but obviously. Well,
I mean...
Spoiler alert!
Then the world...
Killed him again.
Was basically like a portal that went into the world between worlds where you could, like, get glimpses of different points and times and different areas. And Ezra actually ended up reaching through space and time and saving Ahsoka from a battle with Vader. So she was pulled into the world between worlds from the future.
And yeah, then... okay, so rewind. When they first come across Ahsoka in Rebels, one of their first kind of adventures together is going to this this Jedi temple that was actually a Sith temple. Ezra gets trapped. He meets Maul. It's a whole thing.
No, that one was just the Sith temple, the Jedi / Sith temple that was like sitting on top of the other one.
Oh, that
one
was later.
On Lothal.
Okay.
And then they went to the like Sith planet where maybe it was just like the
big... So anyways, Vader came. Yeah. Vader and Ahsoka had a fight, a moment, and that is when Ahsoka starts figuring out that maybe that could be Anakin.
No, she figured that out way earlier, Mom.
At the beginning of the season.
Remember when they're fighting battle. And like his TIE fighter goes by and she's like, oh, Anakin.
No? She's like, or Ezra's like, I feel cold. I feel anger. I feel...
Yeah, it's the same one, right? And then she fights him and he breaks his mask and he talks to her. Well, and that's when she knows.
She knows when they're fighting in space.
Oh, you think?
No. Yeah, because okay. So if you watch season two, the two episodes, they're fighting and he's taking on the whole squadron by himself, just wiping them out. And so the ghost tries to save him and Ahsoka's in there and she starts to feel the presence, but she feels that it's Anakin, but then she feels it's something different. Mm-hmm. And then once she realizes that, like,
think she fully in that when I rewatch that scene, I don't feel like she fully embraces that that's true. I think she starts having that sense, but pushes it away. Doesn't want to accept it. Doesn't want to believe that it's true.
Yeah, but he instantly knows the first thing he says is the apprentice lives.
Yes.
So, so I think she still like senses it's him, but can't believe it in her heart.
Yeah.
Until she.
And then when she does see his face, she's like,
Anakin. And his voice.
Yeah.
Which,
such a good one.
Season two finale might be one of the best finales of anything I've ever seen, even Game of Thrones.
So they end up trapped and fight, right? And the ghost crew have to leave.
Yes. She basically sacrifices herself fighting off Vader so
Ezra
and Kanan can escape.
Yeah. And they never see her again.
Yeah, they assume she's dead. That started the whole Ahsoka Lives thing.
Yes. So we all thought she was dead. That's when Ezra later, when he's in this kind of force space between worlds, that's like a meditative kind of ethereal plane.
Yeah.
Yep. He sees her dueling Vader in that same temple from the past and then reaches through, grabs her, pulls her into the world between worlds. And then later, he tried to do the same with Kanan, but Ahsoka talks him out of it because none of them would have survived if Kanan was not in the position he was in.
And that was a choice. And the Emperor's trying to pull Ezra in because he wanted that.
Yeah.
But I mean, kind of even jumping around back to that Ahsoka Vader. Before that, Kanan gets blinded by Maul, which is a big storyline because after that, that's when Kanan fully gives his all to the Force and becomes a very powerful Jedi in the training. Once we find out later on in like season 3 with the Bendu and all that stuff. Very crazy in finale.
There's just so much stuff.
There are so many good things in Rebels that just, yeah.
And it's only 4 seasons. Not a whole lot of commitment compared to like the Clone Wars series.
Yeah, this is true. But yes, if you want to be more prepared for Ahsoka, this series, you need to at least, at minimum, go in and watch her pieces that are part the Rebels episodes on Disney Plus right now. There's like a Ahsoka special line of shows of the Clone War, a couple of Clone Wars episodes, some of the Tales of the Jedi, and then some of the Rebels, and then the Mandalorian. Brush up on those Rebels ones because those are the storylines that are going to bleed over.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I guess even Filoni's mentioned, like, you don't need to see Rebels to understand what's going on.
You don't. Yeah.
But why wouldn't you? It's so good.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. It just adds to the richness.
Yeah. And do yourself a favor and watch. Cause it is like, I like Rebels more than Clone Wars.
I
think Rebels is one of the best Disney era Star Wars content we've got.
Maybe I'll change my mind after this series comes out.
I mean, and it has the father, daughter, and son.
Yeah.
It's got, I don't know. There's just so many good pieces.
I love the Bendu. I've always been a gray Jedi kind of a person.
I mean,
you know?
Loth cats, freaking the wolves, like so many.
I do have a
Pergil.
I mean,
yeah.
If you're like into the Star Wars creatures universe,
And that's what I wanted to mention about Ezra is like a lot of Jedis have their own special strengths. And so one of his big strengths was be able to tap in with creatures of the Force. A lot of animals, a lot of creatures. So he really ties into or could really like the whole storyline with the Purgles is amazing. And, you know, from when we thought it was just a filler episode to how big of a role they played at the end.
Yeah.
Then we find out watching Mandalorian, that's one of Grogu's traits, too. The exact same being able to connect with animals. He sees the Purgles in the first episode.
Yep.
And then we see him again show up in the trailer. I mean, it's like, so I think that's going to be a connection where, I mean, don't want to say like, oh, there's going to be the rebuilding of the Jedi, but you're going to have two Jedi that have that connection, Ezra, Grogu. We don't know what's going to happen with Jason yet. And they're still going to be around when Ahsoka or Rey
show up. We know that Luke builds the temple, right? And he ends up with a lot of students because it gets destroyed and burned and whatever later, and they all get murdered. We don't know who's there when that happens and when they get murdered and it's destroyed, but we know it's built up and then collapses.
Yeah.
So this is the building stage, right, of his school for the Jedi.
Yeah, and then kind of jump into like Rise of Skywalker, it's like you hear Jedi voices at the end where Rey, you know, is hearing everybody, but you don't hear Ezra. You don't hear we didn't have Grogu at the time, but you don't hear him. Well, we did, but not that. And then I remember hearing.
We don't even know what his voice would be. So.
Exactly.
Maybe we did, and we don't know.
And I was listening to another podcast. I was interviewing Taylor Gray, the voice of Ezra, and he was even asking like Dave. He's like, "Oh, it sucks. Yeah, they didn't ask me to be that voice part in Rise of Skywalker." And Filoni's like, "Well, those voices were of Jedi that were dead," and that's all he said. He's like, "What?" That's all he left him at. So, I mean, maybe we are going to get a beginning of the Jedi with Rey, Ezra, Grogu, Jason. Who knows?
Yeah. See, I feel like even if Hera was given the opportunity to let him join Luke's school, Jason, he wouldn't. She wouldn't let him.
Yeah.
Just Just because. No, that's not a Hera move.
Yeah, exactly. That's her one connection to Kanan.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And she saw how all the real world experience helped Ezra, so I don't think she would be like, here,
yeah,
leave me behind and go with these people. Okay. Where are we just at?
So Ezra's plot from the end of Rebels that we think is going to carry us into Ahsoka. So it's the tie-in of Thrawn. Mm-hmm.
Well, Ezra has a deep connection to Lothal because that's where he was raised. And in the last time we see Ezra, they were trying to basically wipe out all the Imperials that were left on Lothal in, like, this big ship. And then Ezra, I believe he got captured, right? And then he had to fight. That's why he didn't have his saber. Sabine had it. He had to fight his way up to the, like, hall, and that's where he ran into Thrawn. And then all the Purrgils came in.
Yeah, I think they were bombarding the city, mm-hmm. and then Thrawn's like, well, if you don't come here, they stopped fire, they ceased fire, and gave them, like, you know, you got until some time to come, you know.
Okay, yeah.
And that's when, but Hera's like, no, we're not separating, and we'll fight through it, and that's when he kind of gave Sabine kind of like the head nod. And she's like, oh, look at here on the map. And that's when it gave him his, because he's like, I got to save my friends. This is the one way to do it. But they put things into motion throughout. Like, there's so much in the story, like the other characters that aren't there at the time. But they said, be here at this. He told him to be here at this exact time. And that's when the Purrgils showed up, or the wolves showed up. And yeah, there's so much going on there. But it was literally... He foresaw what happened. You know, he tapped in that much into the Force and mm-hmm. knew he was going to sacrifice himself for that.
And we don't know that he literally, like, sacrificed his life.
Well, we definitely know
we just know that he's gone, technically.
But Thrawn was with him when he disappeared, so I feel like if that was, like, him taking him to his doom or whatever, he wouldn't have survived.
Yeah.
So I feel like there's a good chance that Ezra's alive.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
Yeah.
He, like, calls in, because he has, like, connection to the animals and creatures before, calls the Purrgils, which wrap around Thrawn's fleet, and then they jump into hyperspace, and we don't really know where they went. Pretty much is how his story leaves off in the Rebels series. And then, at the very end of the Rebels series, you see the scene that we actually see in the trailer of Ahsoka, where Sabine's looking at the mural, touches Ezra's face in the mural, and then she turns around and Ahsoka's just standing there in the Rebel series, but, you know, it's pretty clear they're going to find Ezra.
Yeah.
Well, and now it sounds like not only was that maybe the direction they were heading ultimately in their minds, it also opens up the window for the training that must have happened between her and Sabine, so...
Yeah, part of me feels like they might have already been looking for Ezra, like, before that scene.
Mm.
Like, maybe Ahsoka left the training of Sabine, possibly, and, like, went to go follow leads to look for Ezra. I don't know. Mm. Speculation.
Yeah, hard to tell. I kind of got the thing that maybe... It sounded like Sabine stayed on Lothal the whole time during the events of 4-6, but might have had some side adventures looking for Ezra. We'll find out, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Any other storylines that will tie in, possibly? That's the big one. For sure.
I think it's pretty clear that we're not going to run into Inquisitors, besides those two questionable Sith users.
There's an Inquisitor in one of the trailers.
Oh, yeah, there is. Yeah. There is, isn't there?
Yeah.
Well, Inquisitor backstory, basically disciples of Vader searching out Jedi during the Empire's reign. And you see him in the Kenobi series. And
we know Ahsoka. Some of them were Padawans from the temple.
Mm-hmm. And they seem to all know who Ahsoka is. Like, when they run into her in the Rebel series, they basically like, oh, we're going to get rewarded.
They know she's a Jedi. In.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So they have some background on who used to be part of the Jedi Order, so they know who she is.
Yeah, so they pretty much have profiles on everybody who was associated with the Jedi after Order 66 who were not confirmed as killed. Because they're also searching for Kenobi and others that they could not confirm were killed in Order 66.
Yep. Like Mace Windu.
Yeah, right.
Anywho.
Yeah, so those two characters, we looked up their names, Baylan Skoll and Shin Hati. I'm fascinated because to me, they don't read full Sith. You guys seem to feel.
Definitely Sith.
That they were definitely Sith.
Ahsoka's like. But who? In the middle, in my opinion. She walks the line.
Who would they have apprenticed under?
Vader, most likely, because that older gentleman.
Well, he referred to him as Anakin.
Exactly. He referred to him as Anakin. Oh,
he was definitely a Jedi.
Yeah.
But their lightsabers are orange more than red.
That's why I'm like, are they really just that other that we haven't really got to explore yet that aren't Jedi but aren't Sith? The gray?
No, they're leaning more Sith for sure. Because I think Ahsoka's more of a gray Jedi. Maybe she's leaning more Jedi.
But she and leans leaning more Jedi. Sith. Exactly, exactly. Yeah.
Maybe there's two sides of the coin here. Maybe this is like a piece of, I don't know.
I think, so her lightsabers are white because she's not a Jedi, but she's not a dark side user. She's still a light side user. But they're are orange because they're not, maybe they're not necessarily Sith, but they're not, they tap in more of the dark side of the Force.
That's true, yes, because how that gets its red color is they, like, bleed the lightsaber, so maybe they have strong Sith tendencies, and they bled their lightsaber, or their kyber crystal, and then it didn't go full red, because they're not fully Sith like that. Maybe.
And no Infantilones involved, we'll probably find out.
Yeah,
hopefully. That would be cool. But if they were trained by Vader, why are they teaming up with Elsbeth in the search for Thrawn versus why wouldn't they have become an Inquisitor? Right? Because it seemed to me that after Order 66, any remaining Force users were either killed or turned into Inquisitors to seek out and kill the rest of anybody else with the Force.
Maybe this would happen. The older guy was a part of the Jedi Order, left the Jedi Order, maybe turned more Sith during the Empire's reign, and that younger girl is his Padawan.
Yeah, I think she's definitely his Padawan.
Yeah, the Inquisitors weren't just looking for Jedi. They were looking for Maul. They were looking for any Force users that weren't under their control, pretty much. So.
Well, these would be the first Force users that were not recruited for Inquisitors, then, that we see post-Order 66, that are allowed to survive.
But we don't know if they were allowed to survive. Maybe they were being hunted.
Huh, that's true.
Because, I mean, they don't have Inquisitor blades.
No.
So.
Interesting. We did not talk about the droid smith.
I brought him up for like a brief moment.
The saber smith droid. The saber creator droid. I don't know. What would you call it? What would his title be?
He had a name, but I cannot remember it.
I just know he's voiced by David Tennant. That's all I know.
We'll just call him Dave.
Doctor Who? Droid who?
Droid. Yeah, he's the droid that pops up in the trailer for a brief moment and says, we have a lot of work to do. And we saw him in the Clone Wars series, basically helping young Padawans build their lightsabers. So, likely that's why we see him here. He's going to go help Luke at the temple, building Padawan's lightsabers, probably taking them to whatever planet they might go to.
To find a Kyber.
Post-Empire to find Kyber crystals, because it definitely wouldn't be the same. Because I'm pretty sure the Empire wiped out a lot of the Kyber crystals. Mm-hmm. You know, mining them and whatnot.
Yeah.
We know this. Mm-hmm. Watch Rogue Run, people. Rogue Run.
Yeah.
Rogue One.
Rogue One's just really good by itself, too.
Yeah.
I think one of the best movies.
Well, the best standalone.
Yeah, 100% down. Best standalone, for sure. Anyway. We're just
squirreling all over the place, as usual.
Okay, that covers the characters.
Covers the main plot point that will carry over. Mm-hmm. What else?
Is there any other maybe side characters that not necessarily you think we'll see, but that you would like to see in Ahsoka?
I feel like I don't think we'd see him, but
we did see one, right, in Rise. Wasn't that guy that stuck his head out of the thing? That Poe? Wasn't that a Rebels character that we ended up seeing?
Oh, at the beginning?
Uh-huh.
I don't think so.
I could have sworn. I'll have to look that one up.
Oh, the green one.
He aided the rebellion in the Rebels series, I thought.
I don't think, maybe it was that one,
maybe I'm mixing up my stuff, though.
That one animated one they made about
the Resistance.
Yeah, the Resistance.
Maybe I'm mixing up my animation now. It's possible.
I think it'd be really cool to see, why am I spacing his name? Fulcrum.
Oh, Callus?
Callus.
Plot twist.
I think it'd be kind of cool to see Callus live action. Maybe, like, come and aid in some kind of rebuilding of the New Republic situation. I don't know. But I feel like it'd just be cool to see, like, maybe him and Zeb are together.
Yeah, right. Buddy cop.
Interesting.
So,
yeah, because we don't know what he's doing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would love to see a live action loth-wolf or
loth-cat.
Yeah.
I think we see the loth-cat. Well, we have a cat in the Mandalorian series. Remember like barish scene? We see one of those.
That's right.
So I think they have to bring one.
Yeah, and I think they had the cat at Comic-Con. Because they had
the exhibit, the Ahsoka exhibit that they had. Yeah.
Yeah. That Sabine's helmet, that a loth-cat. Mm-hmm. A certain lightsaber that wasn't Ahsoka's.
Mm-hmm. I think a loth-wolf would be really cool to see in live action. But, like, logistically, that'd be pretty difficult to pull off.
Yeah.
But I'd love to see it. It'd be very cool if they brought, like, Doom in, you know, like...
Oh. Yeah.
Kind of maybe like... Ooh. Oh my gosh, imagine Doom's training Jason. That's very far-fetched, but it'd be very cool.
If you're wondering who Doom is, go watch the show. Listen. I think it'd be cool. I was actually hoping to see him in Mandalorian Season 3 when more Mando's showing up, but Finn Rao would have been cool.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
He was a big character towards the middle and the end of this. Big support of Sabine's, too. So,
I feel like he'd be more likely to show up in this series than the Mando series, for sure, too.
Yeah, and I know the actor that voiced him is about that age where, I mean, he wants to play him live action, so we hear a lot of that happening. Then, of course, Hondo and Aka would be awesome to see.
See the for the first time in live action. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
I mean, he's at the parks.
That's pretty... I could very much see that happening.
Mm-hmm. I mean, with all their prosthetics and whatnot that they've been doing on the show, Hondo would not be.
And
that
he's in Galaxy's Edge. I mean,
yeah, that's also true.
Keep hyping up Galaxy's Edge wherever they can in content, I'm sure.
I mean, he's a pretty key part of that ride, and we haven't seen him in live action a single time. So, mm-hmm.
And they have the video screen version of him. It's a full prosthetic. So, mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah. And you still have him voiced by Jim Cummings. I mean, he's just give him a call, you know.
Yeah, literally. He's got a mask on, you know.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I'm trying to think of anybody else I'd like to see.
Do Mando and Grogu show?
No, I don't think so.
I mean, I thought that Ahsoka would have had to shown up in the last season of The Mandalorian to, like, play up. Remember how I was sure they were going to bring her in there or some more of the characters, right, to build up the series, and they didn't.
Yeah, they just brought Zeb in there for, like, a little...
So apparently they are pretty confident she can stand on her own that series.
Why wouldn't Dave Filoni be confident?
So...
Yeah.
I don't think they need it. I think it would be... You know, just...
Yeah. You know, honestly, I feel like they should just leave Mando and Grogu out of this series, so it's not like, you know, like another Boba Fett situation.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. I mean, maybe like you can overhear a conversation or something, or...
Yeah, yeah.
You know, she checks in on Grogu's training or something. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe there's like a little... Like, maybe she goes to that planet and ends up running into them.
Yeah.
Like... In a little side conversation, it's brought up. Who knows? But yeah. Is there anything you guys are really hoping to see in the Ahsoka series that maybe we haven't discussed?
Just Thrawn. Just give me all the Thrawn.
He's confirmed. It's okay.
Just bring on the Thrawn.
I've heard rumors, but you know I don't really pay attention to rumors. But in the latest trailer. We have two name drops of Anakin. And we know Hayden has showed up in Obi-Wan Kenobi. Mm-hmm. And I think it'd be pretty amazing to see him show up. But as a Force ghost, not a memory back, you know. As cool as it would be to see live action, you know, younger Ahsoka with Anakin, voiced by Ashley Eckstein. But I would like to see a current like Force ghost Anakin, but I think we're going to see him somewhere in the show.
That would be cool. I think so, too, because I'm pretty sure this is, like, their last opportunity to, like, use him in more of a live-action situation.
And to have him and Ahsoka be able to close the loop. Mm-hmm. Ooh, that gives me chills.
And we've all seen Hayden at the last two celebrations just getting praised, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So. Oh, if we saw him, I would just drop dead. I've been wanting like some kind of scene where Ahsoka finds out that he turned back to the light side so much.
Yeah.
That's all I need.
Well, I mean, they're gonna have to drop something like fan provoking that we don't know about, right? Yeah. They've done that pattern now already. So there's gonna be something cool and big that we don't see coming. You heard it here first, people.
Yeah. I mean, I saw
Anakin Force Ghost.
I saw an amazing art piece of like, it was that scene of Ahsoka talking to Luke in Book of Boba Fett, but it was like leading up to like talking about his dad and, you know, about him being Vader, and then Luke telling her, oh no, he turned at the last moment, and then she just drops to her knees in tears. I'm like, oh my god. You know, wiping the tears off my eyes, but
yeah. Literally, I saw that little like kind of cartoonish clipping like a while ago, and I was like, oh my gosh, I need to say it. I need it in canon.
Yeah, and I want to say, because Rosario is very open on her social medias, and I want to say very early in filming, she tweeted something out to Hayden, or saying like, I forgot what it was, but she's like, all right, let's go, Sky Guy. Or something. I'm just like,
interesting.
But like I said, in the trailer, the dark force user mentions Anakin, and she mentions Anakin in her training. So.
That's true. There's two drops of him in the trailer.
Not Vader, but Anakin. So
that could be some major alluding they're doing right there in the trailer.
Yeah,
that's very true. Yeah, that'd be amazing. Anything anything else you're thinking that you'd love to see?
As long as I get to see the live action ghost, I'm that's my second favorite ship behind the Millennium Falcon, and
yep.
I wanna buy the HasLab one that's coming out. So I'm just excited.
Okay, so you mentioned earlier the name of the gray Jedi or the mercenary Siths, whatever we're going to call them. You mentioned reading before we started talking and recording we'd squirreled on our own and then stopped ourselves. So his name is, in Norse mythology, the wolf that chases the sun. And then his apprentice is the wolf that chases the moon.
Interesting.
And we know Baloney with his wolves.
Yeah, yep. That's...
it's kind of fascinating. It's
definitely alluding to something. Not unintentional, probably.
Yeah, and Wikipedia is just calling them force mercenaries.
Okay, I like that.
That's a new one, but I dig it. I mean, kind of goes back to Hondo talking to Ezra, like, when he finds out he's a Jedi, he's like, oh, well, be a pirate Jedi, you know?
You can be both, why not? Yeah.
And that kind of fit him, actually.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, literally. One thing I'd kind of like to see, I just don't know how they would, like, incorporate it, would be, like, a live-action world-between-world situation.
Yeah.
Like,
right. And at first trailer, we totally thought we were seeing a world between worlds, but second, we realize it's just some kind of device or, like, maybe a holocron or something that's projecting that. Mm-hmm. But Ahsoka's symbol on her title card for the series is definitely the symbols of the world between worlds. So
yeah,
there's got to be some tie-ins here.
Yes, yeah. And Ahsoka's already been in the world between worlds before, so she knows that it exists and what it's all about, kind of. And then Sabine also saw Ezra open the portal to the world between worlds, so she knows, like, kind of where to find these portals, which is, like, around Jedi temples, most likely. Mm-hmm. And we do see Ahsoka in a, you know, pretty old Jedi temple in the trailer.
Yeah. And I know he's not going to show up in this at all, but we still know that it is a time where there's, like, clone emperors being tested or worked on, and he knows about the world between worlds, too.
Yeah,
but I don't think that's going to even be a factor, but the knowledge is out there.
Yeah, I don't think, yeah, he has the ability to go into the world between worlds. I feel like it's a Jedi thing, and that's why he was trying to, like, break in.
Yeah, like he can't get in on his own.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like the whole thing with Maul trying to get the holocron.
Yeah.
Like, there needed to be two.
Yeah, like, remember when he tried to convince Ezra to, like, go into the world between worlds to be with his parents, and Ezra was like, no!
Yeah. Interesting. All right, anything else?
Not for me, I'm just
excited. Pre-Ahsoka series podcasting.
I'm just ready for it. You guys, if you're listening, release it early.
Yeah. Two episodes.
I mean, I'm pretty stoked about. Two episodes.
But we can geek out about Rebels, but if you haven't seen it, just watch it. It's amazing.
Yeah.
It is great storytelling, great characters.
Yeah.
Yeah. Really well made, great characters. It's like, imagine a shortened, condensed Clone Wars, a lot more Dave Filoni style, in the Empire kind of background region instead of, like, the Clone Wars background kind of thing.
Yeah.
Well, and we know we're getting, like, what is it, the Skeleton Crew? What are they called? What's that other series coming out?
I think it's called the Skeleton Crew.
That's kind of, some of that vibe reminds me of Rebels, right? It's like a crew, a ragtag group of
people. Well, we basically see a crew like that in Rebels, that one.
Yeah. So there's, you know, there's elements that kind of plant the seeds for the expanding of the Star Wars universe now that, you know, it's all going to come back to Filoni. And what Filoni's laying down as the...
Yeah, Filoni...
Filoni's, he is the new George plan. Lucas, as far as, like, the Star Wars universe lore and heart, the philosophy behind it, like...
Yeah. Anything that Filoni is in charge of, just watch it. Get behind it.
Yeah. And he's the first one to say it all goes back to George, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. He is George's apprentice.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And has now become the master.
Yes, yes. Yeah, I think that.
That's all I got.
Yeah, it's all right. I got.
Cool. Well, we're hyped, if nobody else could tell, about the Ahsoka series coming August 23rd to Disney Plus. Highly recommend you check out Rebels beforehand if you haven't already. And we'll be back very soon to talk Ahsoka. We got to set some dates here as we go off air for future recordings so we can give you more content as Ahsoka rolls out. So thank you, everybody, for tuning in to Walt's Apartment Podcast Star Wars spinoff, Knights of the Rogue Republic. We'll see you soon. May the Force be with you.
I forget what I say.
Oh, no! It's been too long!
You're one with the Force. The Force with you. I don't know.
What's a rebel? Always a rebel.